Thank you, Georgette, and thank you to Andres, to Avi, and to my partner in leading the Shalom Hartman Institute of North America, Angelica Berry, for your visionary leadership of this conference, and in particular for the opportunity and challenge today to put some big challenges before this whole sector about what has been changing, sometimes slowly and sometimes rapidly, in Jewish life over the past 30 or 40 years, and to ask the question of what will it take for us to confront meaningfully these challenges. I want to put before you today a hypothesis and then ask about its consequences. And the hypothesis is that we Jews in North America have been living through a series of revolutions that we, by and large, have been treating as evolutions. I want to name those revolutions, ask why it is that we've classified them as evolutions, not revolutions, and then, together with my three other panelists, ask what we need to do as leaders in a community to face these real challenges. The three revolutions I want to talk about today are ethnic, or a revolution in identity, political, or a revolution in ideology, and institutional, or a revolution in infrastructure. Now, the reason why it's been hard for us to envision these as revolutions and why we have treated them as evolutions is because of a simple legacy that we took from the 20th century that has gotten into our heads. And that simple legacy is that we were inculcated by the dramatic events of the 20th century to believe that the way in which revolutions happen in Jewish life is through seismic historical events. We all know that the Holocaust, the Shoah, transforms not only the condition of Jews in the world, but changes what we think Judaism means. And so we have bookshelves and libraries full of theology and discussion of what changes for Judaism because of the Holocaust. And we know that the State of Israel doesn't simply change the political condition of Jews in the world, but changes what we understand Judaism to mean. Judaism can't be the same after the creation of the State of Israel. But the result is that absent major historical events for Jewish life in North America, we've been treating the changes that have been overtaking our community for the last 40 or 50 years as slow, iterative processes without recognizing that they are as seismic in their implications and ramifications, not just for how Jews behave, but what Judaism fundamentally means. I want to suggest that these three changes, the ethnic, the political, and the institutional, are no less significant, transformative, and revolutionary for Jewish life than the Shoah and the birth of the State of Israel. And yet we are still operating within the same frameworks of community and meaning to interpret a reality that no longer comports with the one that we once had. The first revolution, the ethnic or identity revolution in Jewish life, goes as follows. Once upon a time, Jews were an us, and there was a clear them. In fact, the fact that there was a them, they, sometimes subtle and sometimes overtly, reinforced the distinction between Jews and non-Jews, even as Jews sought to assimilate. Now, although Jews have never been racially, ethnically, or otherwise homogenous, this story of Jewishness as a fixed ethnic identity has held for a long time. And we assumed for a long time that any diversity that happened within Jewish life operated within a framework that we all understood the boundaries between us and them, and so we just had different types of Jews living within that boundary. There are a lot of specific phenomena that have accelerated the ethnic revolution in Jewish life. Things like intermarriage, adoption, conversion, and even the changed rules of membership for the Jewish people brought about by the State of Israel. But our community tends to treat these as the issue, as opposed to recognizing that they are symptoms of a much larger phenomena, that these are all living within a larger structural framework of the essential disappearance for most North American Jews of the basic difference between Jew and non-Jew. That it's incredibly easy to leave, and it's incredibly easy to join. My absolute favorite statistic, and as a non-sociologist, I can just use statistics for the purpose of serving my argument. My absolute favorite statistic is that in a New York Jewish population study from about 6 or 7 years ago, a full 5%, so 1 in 20 Jews in the New York area, had no Jewish parents and did not convert. in order to explain a phenomenon like this, you have to invent a sociological category. And so the sociological category that gets invented is the phrase voluntary affiliational identity, which means that you can simply join the Jewish people by deciding that you are Jewish. Now, one way to respond to this, as some Jews are doing, is to ramp up their countercultural behaviors and trying to build higher walls. Most Jews, however, like us, are simply waking up to recognize that we've been living through a seismic revolution in everything of what we've understood to be Jewish and Jewish identity, which is very simply that Jewishness today in America is simply a matter of choice. And we're left to wonder, what does membership look like in the Jewish people more broadly, in our institutions and our communities more locally, in a climate like this? We are wondering, how do we confront real radical diversity, not just different opinions about who should be the prime minister of the state of Israel, but real distinctions and differences between our identities and what we think it means to be Jewish? And how do we mount a seriousness or a thickness in Jewish identity that can spread across these incredible horizons and vistas where Jewish diversity has taken place? It seems that the radical breakdown of a coherent notion of Jewish identity is a feature of North American Judaism and no longer a bug. The second revolution in Jewish life in America is political, or if you prefer, ideological. Once upon a time, Jews constituted an independent polity in America with a not fully articulated but relatively dominant shared ideology. Again, it didn't mean that we agreed on politics or religion, but the myth that American Jews told themselves for a long time is that our fights were internal, and you may remember this moment in Jewish history nostalgically, we used to not air our dirty laundry in public. Two big shifts have happened for Jews in America. One, politically, we are not a Jewish community by any measure anymore when it comes to Jewish politics. In fact, the phrase Jewish politics makes less and less sense. We, the word Jewish, is simply an adjective that goes before the other words, Democrat and Republican. And as the fighting between Democrats and Republicans becomes more visceral, the Jewish Democrats and Jewish Republicans fight even more viscerally. Isaiah Berlin said, or paraphrased at least, that Jews are like Americans, but more so, and much is the same the case here. Jews are like political citizens of this society, and our Jewishness no longer speaks to a shared ideology, but simply an adjective. The bigger question, however, is on questions of ideology and meaning. And there's a growing sense that the common Judaism of 20th century Jews in America, which was built around things like a sense of Jewish peoplehood, a loyalty intrinsic to the state of Israel, no longer holds sway. And here again, we are left to ask whether Judaism, not the Jewish people, but Judaism as an ideology, can provide a language of meaning that can compete in a marketplace of ideas where once upon a time simple loyalty to the Jewish people is no longer considered interesting. And so therefore, if we confront this as a revolution, we have a number of big questions. Is there such a thing as common Judaism for Jews in North America? Can there be a consensus Jewish politics? Is that even desirable? And how do we offer a language of meaning to being Jewish that will make people continue to opt into being Jewish when their loyalty to Jewishness can no longer be taken for granted? And the third seismic revolution in Jewish life is that once upon a time, the Jewish community was characterized by a recognizable, defined landscape of institutions with physical infrastructure, the very places where Jews went in pursuit of community, purpose, and meaning. And put simply, the institutional infrastructure built by Jews for 20th century, in retrospect, was designed for 20th century problems. The marker of effectiveness, as most Jewish institutions have already learned on the Jewish communal landscape, is whether or not an institution can compete in the marketplace of ideas and loyalties, and that belonging or membership or relevance can no longer be taken for granted. In fact, most of us are incredibly skeptical about all types of loyalty-based commitments. If our institutions provide for us what we need, we will continue to support them. If they don't, we will either find new institutions or we will create them. And at the same time, this creates an extraordinary culture of clutter and confusion in the Jewish institutional landscape. There's a tremendous culture of boutique organization, niche organizations, all operating under this phrase that we call the innovation sector, but it's not clear that we need all of them. There are gaps between underfunded startups and underutilized infrastructure. As the way I like to put it, for every empty synagogue sanctuary in North America, there's a startup minion meeting in the basement of a church. And so therefore, the pace of innovation may itself not be sustainable. We may need a period of reconsolidation, but the unmaking of the old consolidated infrastructure is not quite done yet. Put differently, Jews are still seeking community, meaning, and purpose, much as they always have. It's just that the destinations and locations where they took that community, meaning, and purpose for granted may not be the right places. Now, I'll apologize, but I ask better questions than I have answers. Each of these questions, confronting seriously a revolution of ethnicity and identity, of ideology and politics, of institutions and infrastructure, requires not 45 minutes on a panel, but deep learning and thinking. And together, this, I think, constitutes a curriculum for the Jewish future that has to develop not just programmatic thinking, but real deep thinking about what it means to be a Jew in North America today. But I have the benefit of sitting, at least for the next little while, with three extraordinary leaders and thinkers in the Jewish community to help us think about and talk about how they themselves are leading through these changes. April Baskin, as mentioned, has the best title in the Jewish community, the Vice President for Audacious Hospitality at the Union for Reformed Judaism, helping the largest denomination of American Judaism rethink the very questions of boundaries and identity that have defined belonging for a really long time. Elie Kaunfer, the visionary president and CEO of Machon Hadar, an institution pioneering a discourse and practice of meaning for a next generation of Jewish seekers. And Sarah Rueven, the chair of Slingshot, which evaluates, chronicles, and advocates for innovation and creativity in the Jewish institutional landscape. Please join me in welcoming up to the stage. So April, I'm going to start with you. And I'd like you to first share a little bit about how the work that you're doing now at the URJ responds to these shifts in notions of Jewish identity and ethnicity. And I would love for you to share as candidly as you can how you see and how you understand the gaps between these myths of identity that Jews have told about themselves for a long time and the actually complex lived reality of American Jews.
Great. Wonderful. Well, it's such a pleasure to be here with my fellow co-panelists, and working with JFN in my last year and a half at the URJ has been such a delight. So it's really a pleasure to be with all of you this morning. At the heart of Audacious Hospitality is the belief that we will be a stronger, more vibrant Jewish community and series and sets of institutions when we not only welcome, but really embrace and incorporate and navigate the diversity that is the reality of modern Jewish life. I often like to say that we tend to think of the diversity in our community and all of its different hues as waves of change. But as Yehuda so eloquently stated, we're no longer looking at waves, we're in an ocean. Diversity is now the ocean of Jewish life. It's no longer a wave. And so the question is, as has been posed, how will we navigate that? Now, as a multiracial, millennial Jewish young professional, I chose to go into a role that might not have been as expected as one would think. I grew up within the Reform movement and had a really wonderful experience, but most of my professional life, I've focused more on issue-specific areas around LGBTQ inclusion, multiracial families, interfaith families, but I was truly impressed with the courage and foresight that Rabbi Rick Jacobs and the Reform movement had in creating this position. It gave me hope. Before I came into this position, I really questioned whether or not I thought synagogues and early childhood centers could remain relevant in this moment. But one of the things that I think gives me a lot of hope, I was recently in Israel on the URJ board mission, and we met with Rabbi Daniel Hartman, and some people were disappointed by the talk that he gave to us because he really laid out the facts very matter-of-factly, but I actually loved it. And what I love about both what he said in his remarks about thinking about how we need to be honest about what our community is confronting and the work of the URJ is that we need to address exactly what you're talking about, Yehuda, and say, here are the demographic changes we're seeing. We're seeing that over 10% of our community are Jews of color, that another estimated 10% are Mizrahi and Sephardi Jews, that at least 20% have a disability, that 71% of non-Orthodox marriages since 2000 have been interfaith. And so we need to really be accountable as institutions and bravely take this on and begin to have different conversations. I often think, and I can tell when I'm in a room, if whether or not we have the proverbial horse blinders on. People ask me what audacious is about. It's quite a word. And one, radical hospitality is a common phrase, but we didn't want it to have the political lilt that has. But for me, audaciousness is about being bold and courageous and holding the tension and saying some of our institutions are incredibly innovative, and many aren't. And yet, as a Jewish community, we are brilliant people, and if we are willing to take the time to invest in relationship and be willing to educate ourselves about the modern day diversity that we have, that we actually can develop smart solutions and new ways of operating that can allow us to evolve in revolutionary ways that can keep us current.
Thank you. Elie, I want to switch to the ideological or the political. And I'd love for you to talk a little bit about how your work with Hadar is addressing this search for meaning by young Jews. And I also want to push you a little bit, which is a few years ago you said in well-publicized remarks that our real birthright is Torah. And the implicit message was our birthright is not merely belonging to the Jewish people, but it's about some sort of pursuit for meaning. So I'd like you to talk about where that comes from, how you see it in your work, and what excites you about this work, about a search for meaning and ideology for American Jews today.
Great. It's really an honor to be on this panel and to be back at JFN after many years, so thank you for having me. I want to state that the idea that Jews are defined by Torah doesn't mean that they're defined by the Torah that makes us all nervous, okay? Whatever you have issues about the Torah, that's not the Torah I'm talking about. But that doesn't mean that I'm trying not to challenge you and me. That is to say, I think when you imagine a world in which people are seeking meaning, what I see from our work is people are not only seeking something that buffets something they already believe. That is to say, I believe in content when it agrees with my preconceived notions. How great for me that the Torah says what I already thought. I think when people are actually searching for meaning, they're searching for a form of challenge, for a form of difficulty. And in that way, I think our ideological heritage, as represented by the Torah, that is not the Torah that you don't like, really is meant to challenge us and to say, can we think about things differently? Or to put another way, here's what I think the real revolution that's kicked off the Jewish people as a people started. The Torah was not reserved for an elite. You could have imagined the founding moment of Sinai of all the elders, let's go up to the mountain, and when we're done getting the Torah, let's bring it back to the riffraff, right? And they can sort of connect to what they want. But in fact, it is a democratic offering. That is to say, everybody has a place in Torah. Everybody has a place in content, in meaning searching. And I think we've lost that that real defining aspect of our people, perhaps because of the moments in the 20th century that you spoke about. At some point, it became focused on either counting the number of Jews as a response to attempts to annihilate us, where the sort of the end game being, you know, we become the longest running culture at the end of time that has survived and we get the trophy. As opposed to some sense of we actually stand for something, where there's a reason why we've survived this long. There's a meaning tie-in. And I think one last thing I want to say about that in terms of as it relates to demographics. By the way, Jews have always failed when it comes to counting Jews. It's usually led to plague in the Bible. I majored in sociology, but I'm no longer a sociologist. But I would say that one of the things that I try to hold on to when we think about, well, how many people are doing this meaning search? You know, if you're going to count them, how scalable is it? How big is it? When you look at the Jewish people, we're kind of small, and we're kind of not going to get that much bigger. Now, I'm okay with that because I actually think that the Jewish people do their best when they are presenting a countercultural idea to the majority. That is to say, the Torah is a countercultural document. It's speaking to a world that doesn't agree with its main principles. And if we as a people stand up for what we believe is the right thing, even and especially if it's counter our current culture, then I believe what doesn't matter is the numbers. What matters is the message. So when you put it together, I think the search for meaning is identified in our heritage by A, something that is democratic, B, something that is hard and challenging, that is to say, something that is not something I already understand and believe in, and C, something that is countercultural, something that is a critique on the larger culture that we are, as you pointed out, so incredibly well embedded in now.
Thank you. Sarah, I want to hear you talk a little bit about Slingshot and where Slingshot sits relative to this question of the institutional landscape transformation in Jewish life. But I'd also want to hear you talk a little bit more broadly. You know, we hear a lot of talk about the innovation sector, but the economy of scale of the total of the innovation sector is still relatively small. So I'm curious for you to give a kind of diagnosis of where we're doing in this changeover of the institutional landscape of Jewish life, and whether or when you think the center of gravity is going to shift from the old institutions to the new ones.
That's a great question. First of all, thank you so much for including me on this panel. It's such an honor to sit with you all. So the first part of that, I from where I sit, Slingshot has become, we produce this guide every year, and it's highlighting the 50 most innovative nonprofits in North America. I think innovative is a word that's thrown around a lot, and I don't think we're really exploring it. Innovative is not a value in and of itself, right? I think that innovation is really intertwined with relevancy, and so when we're talking about all these startup organizations that are popping up, it's really all about the search for meaning that we were talking about and finding relevancy in Judaism, especially for the next generation of Jews. So in that vein, I think that, you know, we talk about all this clutter, and like that's a huge dilemma that I struggle with is, are we creating more clutter or are we strengthening our entire Jewish community? And I would argue that it's actually strengthening because a lot of these startups, you know, are the training grounds for young Jews to really take on leadership opportunities that they wouldn't have otherwise had. I think this huge revolution that's taking place is that it's a decentralization of power, and that all these organizations are really taking a much more bottom-up approach in terms of sharing power with more young Jews, allowing more points of entry for young Jews to take on leadership positions and find meaning in Judaism that they weren't able to find before. So I think that it's a wonderful thing. And I think that it's really a positive thing, and it shows that Jewish life is really at a renaissance right now. It just doesn't look like it did 50 years ago.
Great. So one of the common threads that comes out from all of your comments is a kind of decentralization, a diversification, and if we're going to stick with the alliteration, a democratization of a lot of Jewish life. Whenever you see the rise of a particular trend, it's always important to notice what vacuum is being created on the other side. And so the rise of this trend of diversification creates a vacuum in the sense of the community. And we've said for a long time in our work, there is no such thing as the Jewish community, there are Jewish communities. But I think that there is a little bit, or at least my personal sense is, that there's a little bit of a sense of loss about some notion of a coherent whole that we belong to, that creating a community of learners, as you do, Elie, at Hadar, or identifying the radical diversity in the Jewish people, as you've been doing, April, or these decentralization of institutions, creates, amplifies the perception that we're not in something shared. I want to hear from all of you whether you think there's something being lost in that process, and if so, what is that which is shared that you want the Jewish community, as reconstituted on the basis of diversity, as opposed to in the suppression of diversity, what do you want to be the central values of a newly shared Jewish community that is much more aware of these trends? Elie, let me start with you.
I do think something is lost in that shared sense of the "we are one" slogans that's identified by everyone shows up on Super Sunday or pick your analog. For me, I think the nervousness I have, I have a lot of nervousnesses, but the one that I would focus on in this angle is the question of responsibility. Do I feel responsible for anyone? Or is it just my own personal search for meaning? And I should say, if I get meaning from another place, I will so quickly drop the meaning that you were providing me. Like, if you're not on your A game every single time, I'm moving on to the next meaning provider. And that loss of responsibility or commitment is something that I do worry about, and not from a standpoint of preservation of institution, but just a sense of maybe even stability or some sense of belonging. That's given up when you're always searching for the greatest meaning-making environment. In terms of a shared sense, I think, look, the good news is we are the people of the book, not the people of the books, and there is some sense of canon. Now, what's amazing about the canon that we have in our tradition is it is a canon that is, in its own self-perception, infinite. That is to say, it's not that once you learn the books of the Bible, you are now in, and until you get there, you're out, or you've understood it, and now you've graduated canon school. It's that there is some shared text that we're all working through that no matter where we sit on the spectrum, we can have that conversation, even if we disagree, even if the text disagrees with our own selves. But to have some reference point that is common, I feel like that is more orienting than grabbing the latest meaning-making, internet fad that you could find.
Sarah, what about you? How do you understand this question of is there a loss in a sense of a community? And if so, what should constitute being part of a shared community for Jews in North America?
Certainly there's a loss. I'm not going to deny that. I think that what Elie said before about, we are one, there is something to be lost, but I think there's so much more to be gained. I think, we're all in this room, we all care so deeply about Jewish continuity, and it's all about relevancy. And so if we can't remain relevant to the next generation, the true loss will be loss of Judaism as the soul of Judaism. So it's really keeping the soul of Judaism alive, it's just more spread out. And these micro communities, it doesn't mean that there's any lack of passion or lack of sense of a community, it's been decentralized, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, April?
There's so much I would love to say on this question. it tugs at my heartstrings because I think that I regularly confront in my work a deep sense of loss that people are feeling right now as I speak of these changes, and people are very afraid of being left behind. There are a few things I would say, and I think I would start by saying what's fascinating to me is that I think what we are losing here is our collective understanding that's changing, but that in some ways, we've always been a global Jewish people, as you said yourself, right? When we look in our Torah, we see that Moses and in our texts that Esther were both in interfaith marriages.
and that that actually serviced and was in service of saving the Jewish people. I think that there needs to be a reconfiguring about how we collectively understand ourselves, because while there, in some ways there are new trends, this is something that we actually have a lot. Our text, our Torah, has a lot to teach us about how we navigate this, about how we engage with Yitro, with Jethro, in seeking out the wisdom that people from other faith backgrounds can contribute to our sacred text and our collective and ongoing dialogue and understanding of Torah and ourselves. I also think that this is an opportunity. What this brings up for me, Yehuda, is that because we did such a great job as a community at establishing strong institutions in a climate where it was just a given that people would affiliate, and that isn't the case now, I think some of our relational muscles are weak, and that we need to do a much better job. And this connects to the challenges we have in terms of political conversations, is that we don't right now, I think, know how to be in more effective relationships, how to be able to know the specificity about each other and know the details. I often say that it's never a problem that we saw a difference. It's what we do with that difference when we see it. It's how we engage in it. And I think that it's through that, through having ongoing conversations at the URJ, we have a lot of conversations. There's a broad collective conversation about how we engage millennials. And similar to this piece about change, Yehuda, and what's hard is that we have, I've heard now from many people, from boomers who are feeling a great sense of loss and hurt and anger that they have been left behind. And so for my team, what that looks like is being in conversation and finding out what they need and recognizing the new diverse terrain. Where do we want to enter? What do we know about ourselves? What are we looking for? What are the ways in which we want to be challenged? And we need to have those conversations, which is a big effort, because we're so used to relying in our comfy old chairs that have started to become quite uncomfortable. But I think that there is new furniture available for us that we can move to and be more comfortable and more empowered. But there will be a letting go. But I think some of that's just the letting go of comfort, and that there's actually still a lot that we can retain.
So one of the areas of what you might call methodological disagreement between the way April's been talking and the way Elie and Sarah are talking, or at least is manifest in their work, is how much, when you're in a process like this where everything is changing, one of the instincts is towards the exclusivism or the elitism of those who get it and those who don't. Whereas, you know, if you work for the Reform Movement, that's, you've got a lot of the people, and it can't simply be a kind of retreat of let me focus on only those who get it. It's about moving or shifting the movement. I'm curious for Elie, for Sarah, how do you engender a sense that these are trends that you are trying to bring about for the whole Jewish people when the methodology tends to focus on either small institutions, boutiques led by individual leaders, or cohorts of individuals who are not hugely representative of the whole public? How do you get at that sense that we can be vanguard institutions for the larger community, even if the temptation is to focus on the individuals and the exclusive dimensions?
So I think a lot about partnerships, and I think that can be a really powerful thing. I think this dialogue that we've all been talking about between boomers and millennials, it needs to continue to occur, but it also needs to be a way to meet in the middle. I'm a big fan of legacy organizations partnering with smaller nonprofits. I think there's a lot of knowledge to be gained by working together. I think it's scary for both sides, right? Like, as a startup, I think it's scary because, you know, you kind of lose the cool factor if you're working with a legacy organization. And for a legacy organization, I think it's scary to kind of, you know, give up a little bit of that sense of power and control when you're sharing that power with another organization. But I think there's so much to be gained by, and so much intergenerational conversations that can take place. I think it's so important for us to look towards partnerships and really sharing in that.
I think in some ways there is the myth of the inside and the outsiders, and the people who devote time are the insiders, and outsiders can't join that conversation. I actually think that there are two admissions that need to be made on both sides of those imagined dichotomy. The outsiders have to imagine themselves actually courageous enough to say, I don't know everything. There are things I don't know. And what it means to learn is to admit I don't know something. Now, in our culture, that is not something that people readily admit. You were praised for attending Ivy League schools, and so did I. It's not something that is common among Ivy Leaguers to say, I don't know. But the only thing that Ivy Leagues have in common is they are schools, which presume you don't know something, and that's why you're there. So I think there is some traveling to be made, just a courageous admission to say, I don't know. And I think what also needs to be said on the other side of the imagined dichotomy is, I don't have all the answers. Once I'm on the inside, once I speak the lingo, and anybody who's on the inside knows this, the more you think you know, or the more you're perceived to know, actually, the less you realize you know. Like, once you're in the conversation, you realize that it is so vast that no one can ever achieve knowledge. No one's ever going to make it on the inside. Moses stops at the edge of the promised land. All of our models are one in which the searching and the journey continues. So I think to say that there are a small group of people who dedicate themselves with hours of study, and that is the elite and the inside, sort of papers over the possibility that we all can join in on the learning journey at whatever pace works for us, but it involves all of us saying, we aren't done. And that is really hard. It's really hard for this room to do. It's very hard for a rabbi to do. But if we do that, if we say, I don't know, there's just tremendous upside to actually encountering the unknown.
So let me ask one last question and take 1 minute each. You can see the clock. One last question, which is as follows. If there's one thing that you would want to see trends in philanthropy that would address these challenges, these massive challenges, I don't mean I want a pony, right? I mean not specific requests, but ways in which you would want to see this field embrace the pace of change, what would you like it to look like? April, I'll start with you.
I would say it's twofold. This is already happening to some extent. It is and it isn't. But there are some major trends that I named in the area of diversity of Jewish identity around interfaith families, Jews of color, LGBTQ Jews, Jews with disabilities. And I think that there could be a really helpful partnership between working with some large, within our movement and with other large institutions who are willing to be accountable and say, you know what, we might not be fully up to speed and we are willing to engage in that work, but to center some of the voices of people who are most directly affected by marginalization in the Jewish community who want to be involved. I think that that's part of the solution to some of the issues around assimilation and lack of affiliation is actually engaging with a number of leaders who are on the fringes of Jewish life, and there are literally thousands of them who haven't yet had an on-ramp into the Jewish community. And we see pockets of that, whether it's through a number of different initiatives, Joshua Venture, the Schusterman Foundation. That's part of why I'm at this seat. I had a great affirmative experience, and yet there were constantly times in Jewish life where I was asked to leave, where I was confused as hired help. And it's through an influx of resources by philanthropists who believed in my leadership that I am in this position today working within a mainstream movement. And so I think that if we look at some of those pockets of opportunity where there are literally thousands of people who are dying to get support and engagement and partner with institutional partners, I think that we can have some tremendous progress.
Great. Ellie?
I think my ideal is that we make some big bets. Really big bets. I'm sitting here with a double hat as a member of the Grinspoon Foundation board, and PJ Library is a bet that you can influence a tremendous number of people by sending free books to every Jewish family you can get a hold of in America, Israel, Russia, and beyond. That just took the vision of somebody who said, we can do this, and make a humongous bet. You think about Birthright, you think about Chabad in a totally different model. I think the flip side of making a big bet is
banning one-year non-renewable grants. That's a small bet.
Now, that's not to say that things like Slingshot haven't gotten tremendous things off the ground. I have personally a lot of gratitude towards initiatives that take those baby steps, but I think we're all going to be called to account, and all of us in this room probably even more specifically, for not taking the big bets that are going to catch up with the realities that Yehuda described.
Sarah?
I couldn't agree more. I think what I would like to see, especially as a millennial myself, even though I hate that term, and I actually think that we need to stop thinking about millennials and we need to start thinking about the generation that's younger than us, Generation Alpha, as they like to call it, but we're beyond that point. But I think what I really want to see is I want to see organizations, especially legacy organizations, really allowing millennials to have a real seat at the table, an authentic seat at the table, not just like, go get me a millennial, like we're unicorns in Jewish life, but really taking the time to think through, how are we going to work together? How are we going to include millennials? Because millennials, you know, I'm speaking for my generation, but I do think it's very true. We care about issues. We want to be involved. We want to be involved in a real way. And I think that's what needs to happen.
So I'll just say as one last word, my own answer to that question, as the privilege as the moderator, is that the theological and political technology that turns one of the things that you all described, which is this growing diversity in Jewish life, it turns diversity from a problem that's challenging our old realities into actually a feature that describes the realities we want to live with, is summarized by the word pluralism. And a serious investment in the kinds of pluralistic work that these organizations do, that many people are doing here, could actually be one of the vehicles by which a community sees existential challenges and finds itself capable of actually withstanding them. Please join me in thanking our panelists for today.